Okay. On the first that I will give you on Wednesday, you need answer only one problem of the three. And then if you wish, you could do the other problems for extra credit, but it is not required. So let's see, in our first problem, we have an inverse demand function of 10 minus Q and a marginal cost that, thankfully enough, is always equal to zero. So that will make the problem easy to solve, I think, but let's take a look. So there is what we know. The Q is its output and P is the price of the good. Let us say it's the pizzas. And then the marginal cost is always zero in this problem, which in fact may be realistic if we are talking about the internet. Just replicating a web page costs virtually nothing. Since we have a linear demand function, as always, marginal revenue has the same intercept and a slope that is twice as steep as for demand. So let's begin by graphing this simple example. So Adana runs a pizzeria that has a monopoly because she has the only pizzeria that sells blue cheese in Iwate. There is the demand function. If Q is equal to zero, then the price is 10 in this case. So there is the vertical intercept. And then if the price is zero, I've done it to sell 10 pizzas per day. So there is the horizontal intercept. Now, marginal cost is only zero, so it coincides with the horizontal axis. But and then finally, let's add marginal revenue. So since its slope is twice as steep as for demand, it will intercept the horizontal axis at a point that is only half as large as for the original demand function. So since the horizontal intercept is 10 for demand, it is 5 for marginal revenue. Okay, so far. So, as always, the monopolist will produce the amount of output at which the marginal cost is equal to marginal revenue, because the condition guarantees that Ivana will make money on each and every pizza that she sells. So in this case, she is producing 5 pizzas. And then to determine the price, she will consult her demand function, which gives the maximum price that anybody is willing to pay for the 5th pizza. And you can almost determine, just by looking at the graph, that the price would be 5. But let us verify that. Okay, so marginal cost equals marginal revenue. Using assumptions, 0 is equal to 10 minus 2q. So let's solve the q by adding 2q to both sides. And then dividing by 2, which gives us the level of output of pizzas that the method might have done as profits. She will sell 5 pizzas per day. So now, our next question is to calculate the benefit loss in this case. In other words, how much surplus are consumers having to give up because Ivana is acting as a monopoly? So what do you think? What is the deadly loss in this case? So this is a consumer surplus that could have been enjoyed had Ivana produced 10 pizzas rather than 5. by 10 because the additional teachers from the 5th to the 10th are generating marginal value net of marginal cost. But in this case, marginal cost is zero, and so any positive marginal value, which would be the opposite than the demand function, would justify producing that particular pizza. Okay, so far. So our dead weight loss, as may seem familiar, consists of the right triangle of right down the points A, B, and C. That represents the dead weight loss because the triangle area adds together the marginal value of each and every teacher from the 5th to the 10th. So let's calculate the dead weight loss using the Pythagorean theorem. This is 1/2 times weight times height. But I'm using the asterisk for multiplication. So the T of this is 10 minus 5. Or 5. And our height is 5 minus 0. So our calculation is 1/2 times 5 squared, or 25. Or 12.5 of dollars in this case. This is the dead weight loss that is incurred only by consumers. I've done that just that face a separate benefit loss because marginal cost is zero anyway. Okay, any questions about that problem? Okay, good. Please feel free to raise questions at any time. So now let's look at the second problem. Now, marginal cost is not always zero. Instead, marginal cost is rising with each additional pizza. Also, a realistic situation. If, for example, Arizona has to hire additional employees to produce more pizza, those additional employees may demand to be paid over time, and therefore the cost of producing another pizza is rising. So once again, you have a simple and linear inverse demand function, the same as before. But now, marginal cost, although being very simple, it is not quite as simple as in the first problem. Now, each and every additional pizza cost more than previous pizzas. Marginal cost rises as output rises for Arizona. And then because demand has not changed, marginal revenue has not changed either. So let's graph that problem. There is demand again with the same intercepts as before. And the same marginal revenue term or function as before. But now marginal cost is rising with Q's output. For example, if Q is zero, marginal cost is zero as well. So there is the marginal cost function. And now I develop the effect marginal revenue to marginal cost, and then search the highest price that you can to maximize profits, as you should. Okay, so all that we need to do now is to determine output and price. So let's see what we have. Output is determined by the number of teachers at which marginal cost equals marginal revenue. That is 2 is equal to 10 minus 2q. So let's solve the 2 in this case. Adding 2 to the both sides will give us 10 on the right hand side, and then solve the 2. But dividing 2 by 3 So I download the cell 3 and 1/3 pieces on average today. Notice that she is selling fewer pieces than she had in the first problem, because now the additional pieces cost something to produce. In terms of a variable cost, people not worry about fixed costs in this problem, because this is a short run problem. All right, so now all that we need is the price. Price is 10 minus Q. And in this case, 2 is 10 over 3. So let's express the right-hand side in terms of the same denominator of three. Or 30 minus 10 all divided by 3. So all that I have done is to multiply 10 by 3 over 3. So the price is almost $7 for a teacher, something over 3. So now, you know, what I don't should do, but however, from the point of view of society, calculate the dead weight loss of producing fewer teachers than could have been possible. So now, we may have an apparent difficulty in that the total dead weight loss is no longer a right triangle. Other than not to worry, let's divide up that area into two right triangles in this case. So that is the competitive solution in this case at point A. A represents the number of teachers that a competitive market would have produced. Since this point intersects at this point, we have the price given by the demand function is equal to marginal cost. So you remember that the competitive firm does not have enough presence in the market to determine the price. The competitive firm has to take the price as given by the market. In this case, the price is determined by equivalent to marginal cost. So there is the expression for price, marginal cost is Q. And solving for Q, we find that in a competitive market, five teachers could have been produced. But then finally, this first equals 10 minus Q. In the competitive outcome, this is 10 minus 5. That is, the pizzas are selling for $5 per pizza. Okay. So now we have divided the bid loss into two parts. First, the right triangle on top. Let me bring up the points. And the right triangle in the bottom of the debate loss. So I will denote that point as D. Okay, so a question to do is, why economically does it make sense to divide up the total bid-bid loss into these two different triangles? But let's see. Let's take a look first at triangle ABC. So you know that this triangle represents the loss of consumer welfare of better due to cutting back total output to the monopoly outcome. That is, by selling about 3 pizzas rather than 5. This point is easy to determine because marginal cost is equal to Q. So for any point on marginal cost, Q is equal to P, output is equal to price. Okay, so first, note that the triangle ABC is the loss to consumers of not producing all pieces that would have been possible. In this case, as a monopolist, a donor will produce 3 and 3 pizzas. But you could have produced 5 instead and still have covered our marginal cost. So the big loss to consumers. Yes, the turn invoke ABC. Since that triangle represents marginal value for each and every additional pizza net of marginal cost. So let's see, let's calculate the debate loss. Again, using a formula from Pythagoras. Just a tip of the hat to Pythagoras. So in this case of the length is 5 minus 10 over 3. And the height of the triangle is given by the difference between the monopoly price and the competitive price. We already have seen that the monopoly price is 20 over 3. So the height is 20 over 3 minus 5. So I will convert each expression on the right-hand side to thirds by multiplying in the burden 5 by 3. And the same thing for the second expression. Now I've taken this number and multiplied and divided by 3. So the deadweight loss to consumers is 1/2 times tried for the sea. Don't start with the tree. Or one half times 25 over 9. That is 25 divided by 18. And then we are making progress. But we are still not done because we still need to calculate the second half of the big balls. That is the triangular area of ABD. In economic terms, let us ask, what is represented by the birthday loss? If the birthday loss on the top represents the loss to consumers, what must be the case to the birthday loss in the bottom of the entire area? Remarkably enough, this is the loss in profits. That is inferred by Adana, the monopolist. So let's see why that is the case. Had Adana produced 5 pizzas rather than about 3 pizzas, if she could have charged a price of $5 to each additional pizza and still cover her marginal cost. That is, she could have charged a price of $5 to pizza. And still cover her multiple cost, which is no higher than $5. So in the triangle, we assume that Adana could have charged $5 and then the cost of each additional pizza is lower than $5, so she could have had a profit. So let's calculate the dividend loss to the monopolist. NDD. So now that we have a right triangle, we can apply a familiar formula. So don't have since that the rate in the case 5 minus 10/3. To the height, which again is 5 minus 10/3. So let us work that out. We have 1/2 times 15 minus 10. So I multiplied and divided 5/3. And the same thing for the remaining term. Simplify again. Or 1/2 times 55/9. But that is 55/18. So the monopolist, curiously enough, is suffering a dead loss that is as large as the loss to consumers. The total dividend loss is 2 times 25/18. Or 50/18. Which simplifies the dividing 2/2 to 25/9. And there is a problem. Problem solved. Okay, so far on that problem. Any questions so far? Okay, good. So that brings us to the extrapyramidal problem. You can at least outline a possible solution to that problem. So here's our information. The same inverse demand function as before. But now we have a marginal cost, a 7 minus 2 divided by 2. In other words, marginal cost now is declining as output rises. But this again is typical for the internet. And also typical for any firm that enjoys scale economies. But just the scale economies, I mean that average cost is falling as the firm produces more. For example, maybe users learn by doing. They learn how to produce a spacecraft by producing lots and lots of space vehicles. Therefore, the more that they produce, the cheaper it becomes to produce one more unit of the product. To see what this involves, let's take a look at the overall structure of the margin. And so here is the market for convenience markets. She enjoys scale economies in this production. As always, demand is done with sloping. But now we have declining marginal cost. And therefore, average cost is falling as well. Excuse my poor penmanship. Average cost is falling because marginal cost is pulling it down. This is not the cost. That is, marginal cost is lower than average cost, as you can see in the graph. Okay, good. So let us consider what is optimal and what is possible. It could be for society optimal for Kavina to produce at the point the price equals marginal cost. And that occurs at point A. But now Karina has a problem. At that point, A, first is lower than average cost. That is, average cost higher than the price. So if the reader produces this amount, people lose money. Because the price which she receives on each rocket is not covering the cost of the typical rocket. So what is optimal is not always possible. So instead, Karina will try to produce as many rockets as she can and still not lose money. She breaks even when the price is equal to average cost. then the threat disappears at point D. So I will call this amount as 2-1. Sorry, 2-2. And the optimal, the impossible amount, call that 2-1. So the problem is asking you to determine 2-1 and 2-2, and then the birthday loss that occurs because Torita is producing 2-2 rather than 2-1. So of the dividend loss of the trust in this case the dividend loss to consumers this is triangle ABC. That is, had Torita produced 2-1 markets rather than 2-2, consumers would have improved value. This is higher than the marginal cost. So you are now in a position to determine 2-1, 2-2, the price and the birthday loss. But I will pause there for now to give you a chance to try the problem for extra credit, and then we will reconvene on Wednesday to see how far to the classroom. By Wednesday, and we will solve the problem then. This is about previous markets. This is a serious problem in the internet because virtually all internet firms are facing declining marginal costs. The analysis says that firms on the internet can at best to even to turn up the distribution of the world down because people lose money in that case. So, believe it or not, this is the terms for example, first money blocks are not producing enough. But because they cannot profit at the optimal level of output. A little hard to believe, given the policy broad purpose to sometimes see, but that's what the analysis shows. Okay, any questions about the third problem?
So, no questions, thank you.
Okay, good, thank you. So, feel free to try it for extra credit on the Wednesday afternoon, and then people go over the solution as a class. One hint on problem number three, you may want to try some calculus that may help. Okay, so now for a few minutes, you can go back to philosophy. So remember that people considering whether Afghanistan should provide food aid to Pakistan should provide food aid to Afghanistan. And there was some suggestion that that kind of policy may have winners and losers. Pakistan residents are losing food, but Afghanistan is gaining the food. So perhaps there is no political improvement in that case. However, this does not mean that the status quo is good. It just means we cannot provide, we cannot apply provincial efficiency to this problem. We must apply another criterion that may be economic. Up to you. for example, suppose that every person has the same utility function. It just depends on income. So just an example, utility satisfaction is equal to 1 divided by y. Well, y is income. So the marginal of the utility of the rich is lower than the marginal of the utility of the poor. Since the poor must have some money in order to survive. And the rich do not. This, of course, is utilitarianism. So, the proof that the typical proof of study is richer than the typical Afghan. Then much of the utility of another piggy will double. Is lower for the current study since we have that. So, of top of the authority to society, to both nations, your wise. If we start so soon, from Kazakhstan to Afghanistan. So this is one possibility. This is not a political improvement, but another way of approaching the problem. So what do you think? Is utilitarianism a sensible approach? approach to take to this problem. You'll notice that we assume that everybody has the same utility function. And that the marginal utility of n times is declining. Since in reality, we cannot observe utility, there is no scientific way of determining visible assumptions are correct.